Winter's Secret. Winter Black Series, Book 6. Written by Mary Stone. Narrated by Brittany Goodwin. Chapter 1. Horror movies always made Natalie nervous, especially if she watched them late at night. Though she assured herself that the unease wouldn't follow her home from the theater, a chill flitted down her back as she pushed open the front door to her house. She paused to turn around and wave to her friend, but when the quiet engine hummed to life, she remembered she was on her own. Rather than focus on the supernatural scenes that had made the film they'd just seen so unnerving, she tried to mentally take stock of the cinematography and the acting. Sometimes, if she examined a scary movie to admire all its separate parts, she could alleviate the creep of anxiety. In fact, the friends she'd accompanied to the theater that night had given her the suggestion. They were both horror aficionados, and about once a month they would pile on her couch to watch movies and eat popcorn and other snacks. Their comments on the plot and characters tended to keep Natalie's fright at bay while in the comfort of her home, but they'd gone out this time. And she, nearly 30 years old or not, was now officially spooked. She rubbed at the goosebumps rising on her arms as the red taillights of the car faded away. "Stop it," she scolded herself, firmly shutting the door. She was a married woman, after all. Nearly 30 years old. She no longer believed that monsters hid in her closet. She didn't, damn it. But the thoughts wouldn't stop. It was probably because they had been in a public theater, and both friends had, rightfully so, remained silent as they ate their popcorn. Natalie could only assume the lack of commentary was the reason for the overwhelming rush of nervousness as she flicked the silver deadbolt into place. Stepping out of her flats, she retrieved the phone from her back pocket to check for a new message from her husband. John's normal shift extended into the mid to late evening hours, but he was often roped into staying to help the late-night shift supervisor fill out paperwork, take inventory, or any number of responsibilities. Sure enough, the last message had been received a half hour before the movie. The message advised her he wouldn't be home until late that night, but he hadn't sent a follow-up to estimate a time. With a sigh, Natalie turned on each light as she made her way out of the foyer and into the kitchen. The fact that her husband, a retail manager, worked longer and more erratic hours than Natalie did as a flight attendant never ceased to amaze her. Chances were good that by the time John returned home from a 12-hour shift, she would be asleep on the couch, a half-eaten bowl of chips on the coffee table in front of her. As she reached to open the cabinet where they kept the snacks, she paused. Then she smiled. No, tonight she didn't have to eat chips for dinner. John had made enough chicken parmesan to feed an army, and they had leftovers that would last well into the apocalypse. The smile remained as she stepped over to the next cabinet, but as soon as she opened the door and retrieved a plate, the smallest of sounds caught her attention. It was the sound of someone breathing. Close. Right behind her. Her heart all but leaped into her throat as the icy rush of adrenaline surged through her body. But before she could move or even shout, a sharp sting bloomed at the base of her neck. "It's just a bee," she thought, but only for a second. Even as she raised a hand to slap at the source of the pain, darkness enveloped her vision. All the muscles in her body went slack, and she felt the plate slip from her grasp. Just as soon as the ceramic shattered against the floor, she felt herself falling. Though she couldn't be sure she was actually falling, the sensation was dreamlike, almost as if she were suspended in an unfeeling void. The next thing she felt was her head hitting the floor. Then, merciful nothingness. With a sharp breath, Natalie jerked back to consciousness. Her sleep had been deep and dreamless, and at first she assumed she had just woken from a nightmare. She had fallen asleep. At least she thought that must be what happened. But if she'd only fallen asleep, then where was she now? The faint scent of must and mildew in the air mingled with another smell she couldn't place. Iron? Maybe copper? Why would the air in her house smell so musty? And why would it smell like metal? As she squeezed her eyes closed in an effort to clear her vision, to think, she reached to rub her temples. Or tried to, at least. The binding around her wrist clinked as something sharp and cold dug into her skin. What? She breathed, pulling harder, then harder still. She didn't stop until the bite of the metal into her wrist was too much to bear. Panic clawed its way in to overtake her rational thoughts as she tried to make out the few details of the surrounding area. With her free hand, she touched the cool metal that still cut into her flesh. A pair of handcuffs, one closed around her arm, and the other around a pipe or a pole. She couldn't tell. She thought she could see the shape of her arm, but for all she knew, the sight might have been a figment of her imagination. Unless the house she shared with John held a secret room that the realtor hadn't mentioned, Natalie was certain she was no longer at home. The basement of their split-level residence was finished, and even the cement floor of the laundry room was more refined than the rough surface where she now lay. Biting her tongue to stifle a surprised cry at the realization, she pushed herself to sit. Each motion was more arduous than the last, her limbs feeling as if they were trapped in a vat of molasses. The fingers of her bound hand were cold and tingled from the lack of circulation. Strands of her shoulder-length hair were matted to the side of her face with sweat, and her head pounded with every beat of her heart. This must be a dream. Any second, she would wake up to the drone of the television as another rerun of a cooking show came to an end. Teeth clamped together, she pulled her knees up to her chest and closed her eyes. Was she in hell? Had she died in her sleep? Had she ever really bought a house or married Jonathan Faulkner? Or was this where she had been the entire time? Had their uneventful, albeit peaceful life in Baltimore been an illusion? No, that was ridiculous. She needed to get her thoughts under control if she wanted any chance to figure out where she actually was. Eyes closed, she relaxed her shoulders, inhaled, and counted to 8. Clenching and unclenching her hands, she exhaled and repeated the process. 8 in, 4 out. 8 in, 4 out. The icy tinge of adrenaline and fear still chilled her, and her palms were still clammy, but the swirling vortex of far-fetched scenarios had calmed enough to allow room for rational thought. Before she started to walk back through her most recent memories, her breath caught in her throat. There was someone else in the room with her. She had been unable to hear their breathing over the rush of her pulse, and even now, she had to strain her ears to make out the sound. "Hello?" she managed through chattering teeth. The word was little more than a squeak. "Is someone there?" No matter how diligently she tuned into the still world around her, the silence was deafening. There was only more of the quiet, ragged breathing, accompanied by an occasional gurgle that wasn't natural. Natalie had never been an expert in the health field, but even she could tell that the person at the other end of the room was in bad shape. "Can you hear me?" she asked. A low moan was her only response. How had it come to this? As hard as she tried, she couldn't remember a single event after the plate had slipped out of her grasp. Without a doubt, the sting she'd felt in her neck had to do with the inky darkness by which she was now surrounded. Why? And better yet, where? Who? What in the hell was going on? As if on cue, a muffled thud sounded out in the distance. The slat of light that pierced through the gaps in the door frame seemed as bright as an overhead fixture. The door eased open with a rusty creak, and she thought she might have been witness to the explosive death of a star. Tears rolled down her cheeks from the sudden sting of the light, She used her free hand to block out a portion of the glow as the sound of footsteps grew nearer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.